Hello students, welcome to my session on filaria primitives. So far we have discussed about what do you mean by filaria, what are the different types of, what do you mean by primitives, and what are the two types of polygons, concave polygon and convex polygon, right? So if I take any concave polygon, say for example this is my concave polygon, if I have to fill in the color for this particular polygon, right, so then it will be very difficult for me in order to fill the color because of its shape, right? Whereas if I take a convex polygon, it is easy to fill the color or any pattern inside the convex polygon, right? So what we are doing here basically is, in order to fill color to a concave polygon, we will split it into convex polygons, right? So I can split this particular polygon, say for example like this, right, and I get so many convex polygons. Here one convex polygon I am getting, here a convex polygon, and I have a convex polygon here, right? So our next topic is splitting concave polygons, right, so that it will be easy for me to fill color or pattern inside my polygon. So the next topic is splitting concave polygons. There are two methods, right? So basically we'll be splitting the concave polygons, right, using edge vectors and edge correspondence. Right? So the concept behind splitting concave polygons is by making use of the edge vectors and edge correspondence. Already I have told you what do you mean by edge vector, right? So every edge in a polygon is represented by a vector, right? So and edge correspondence, right? By identifying the corresponding edges, right, we will be splitting our concave polygons. So there are two methods in this splitting the concave polygons. The first method, we call it as the vector method. The first method to split the concave polygons is called as the vector method, and the second method is called as the rotation method. Rotation method. These are the two methods of splitting the concave polygon. Right? Let us see one by one how to split the polygons by using the vector method and by using the rotation method. So the first one is using vector method. Okay. So the vector method says that first we need to form the edge vectors, right? So this has so many steps. First step is we have to form, or we need to form the edge vectors. First represent the polygon in terms of the edge vectors. That is the first step, step one. Second step is we have to consider consecutive edges. That means if I start from edge E1, right, then I have to go to edge E2, E3, E4, E5, E6 and so on. That is what we mean by consecutive edges, right? So say for example, I have one vertex by name VK, the other vertex is VK plus 1, right? So then the edge vector, which is EK, is denoted by EK will be equal to VK plus 1 minus VK. Right? That means the end vertex minus the start vertex. The edge vector EK is represented by VK plus 1 minus VK. The third step is to calculate the cross product of the successive edge vectors. Right? So first step was to represent the polygon in terms of edge vector, right? So second step is we have to find the successive edge vectors, that is E1 to E2, E2 to E3 and so on, right? So step 3 is to calculate the cross product. Step 3 is to calculate the cross product of the successive edge vectors. Step 3 is to calculate the cross product of the successive edge vectors, right? So step 4 is to verify the result of this cross product. We have to see the result of this cross product, right? So if I get a combination of positive and negative values, then I will tell that this type of polygon is a concave polygon. If I get all positive else all negative, then I will characterize the polygon as a convex polygon. Let us take an example. Let us take one example for checking whether the polygon is a concave polygon or convex polygon, right? So consider this as my coordinate axis representation, x and y. So this is my 0th point, 1, 2, 3. So here also I have 1, 2, 3, right? So my polygon is like this. The first edge is from here to here. This is my E1, right? So one more edge is here to here, right? So this is my E2 edge. This is E1. This is E2. This is E2, right? So then edge E3 is coming down here. This is my edge E3. Then I have edge E4. This is my edge E4. Next I have my edge E5. Right? And finally, I have my edge E6, which is coming back to this particular end, that is Z. Right? So in this figure or in this polygon, this is my polygon like this, edge E1, E2, right? Then E3, E4, E4 to E5, E5 to E6 back. Right? So now I have to write the edge vector. How to write the edge vector, right? So any edge vector comprises of three dimensions, right? X comma, Y comma, Z. Since this particular polygon is on X and Y axis, right? So our Z axis is 0. I am considering a two-dimensional polygon. It is not 3D. So if I take a 2D, then my Z axis will be 0. So coming to the first edge vector E1, right? So E1 is going 1 unit on x axis. It is moving 1 unit on x axis. So I write x as 1. It does not have a y axis component, right? And since it is 2D, we don't have z, right? So 1, 0, 0. How did I write 1, 0, 0? Because the edge 1 is moving 1 unit on x axis. So next edge is E2. E2 is from this particular point to this particular point, right? That means what? It is moving 1 unit on x and 1 unit on y. The edge E2 is moving 1 unit on x and 1 unit on y. So I write E2 as 1, 1, 0. Hope it is clear, right? Edge E1 is moving 1 unit on x axis, whereas edge E2 is moving 1 unit along x and 1 unit along y. Here is my vertex, right? So the edge is moving like this. It is covering 1 unit on x and 1 unit on y, right? So I will get my edge vector as E2 is equal to 1, 1, 0, right? So coming to edge E3. Edge E3 is again moving 1 unit on x axis. It is moving 1 unit on x axis. And it is coming down 1 unit on y axis, right? So whenever we are moving down, we have to represent with negative value, right? So 1 unit on x axis is positive and 1 unit along negative y axis. So 1, -1, 0. 1 unit along positive x and 1 unit along negative y. Next I have E4. E4 is starting from this particular point till this particular point. Right? So it doesn't have anything on x-axis, it is moving along y-axis, so I write it as x0, right? And my z component is 0. Right? So now if I come to y-axis, right? So look here, whenever we are representing any polygon using edge vectors, right? In a vector representation, it is continuous traversal. It is continuous traversal. So when I have like this, already I have moved till here. Already I have moved till here. My vector is what? It is from 0 to 3. My vector is from 0 to 3 and I have already covered this 0 to 1, right? That is why I have to subtract from this entire 3, 1. I will get the value as 2, right? Because I have already covered till this particular point, right? So the remaining part which the vector needs to cover is the 2 units, 1 to 2 and 2 to 3. This is the remaining part it has to cover because already till 1 we have reached. Right, so I will write it as on y-axis it has to cover 2. Then coming to the edge vector e5 is moving along x-axis. It doesn't have y-axis, and how it is moving? It is moving negative x-axis, right? So how many units? From 3 to 2, 1 unit, 2 to 1, 1 unit, and 1 to 0, 1 unit. So it is moving minus 3 units along the x-axis, along negative x-axis. That is why it is minus 3, and we don't have any y component in my edge vector 5. Minus 3 comma 0 comma 0, right? So same thing holds good for edge vector 6. E6, it doesn't have any component of x-axis because it is here. The edge vector E6 is here. It doesn't have any component along x-axis. So coming to y-axis, already we have covered this part. Right, so from here till here we had moved, from there we moved like this, we moved like this, right? So we have to come back this, right? And there we are moving down, that is why it is minus 2 along the y-axis. This is how we represent the edge vectors, right? So edge vector e1 is what? It is along x-axis 1 unit, so it is 100. Coming to edge vector e2, it is 1 unit along x and 1 unit along positive y, so it is 1 comma 1 comma 0. Coming to edge e3, it is from here. From here, 1 unit along x-axis and 1 unit along negative y-axis. So it will be 1 minus 1, 0. Right? Since we have already reached here, so edge e4 will be 0 along x-axis because it is moving only along y-axis. So it will be 0 comma 2 comma 0. Right? So next coming to e5, e5 will be minus 3 along x-axis. We are coming from 3 back to 0. So 3 units along negative x-axis. Coming to e6, already we have reached from here, right? So we have to come back here, right? So that it will be joined, right? So negative y-axis, so we will get it as 0 minus 2, 0. This is how we represent the edge vectors. This is our first step, right? So once we represent the edge vectors, the second step is we have to find the cross product. The second step, which is step 2, is we have to find the cross product. I'll show you an easiest way of finding the cross product, right? Say for example, we have two vectors, let vector AB equal to 7, 3, minus 4, and vector B is 1, 0, 6. This is an example to find the cross product, right? So how do we find the cross product of vector A cross vector B, right? So the simplest method is just write the vector values of A and B in a row wise, right? Two times, so 1, 0, 6, 1, 0, 6. Then what we have to do is we have to leave the first part, right? So we have to calculate the determinant, right? So three components are there. Any vector will have three components, x, y and z values. So multiply these two, I will get 3, 6 is 18 and 0 minus 4 is 0. So 18 minus 0, my first answer is 18, right? So then what I will do, I will multiply minus 4 and 1, so minus 1. Minus 4 into 1 is minus 4. Minus 6 sevens is 42. These two, right? Again, you have to take minus sign, multiply these two. So these two again take minus sign, multiply these two. The same way here, 3 6 is 18, 18 minus into minus is plus, 0 into 4 is, sorry, we should multiply these two. So I will get it as 7 into 0, 7 into 0 is 0 minus 1 into 3 is 3, right? So I repeat, just take the values and write it as 2 times, right? So in a row, we get it as like an array we have to write. So 7 3 minus 4, 7 3 minus 4, then I have 106, 106, right? So I multiply, leave the first two values, 3 6 is 18 minus 0 into minus 4, which is 0. 18 minus 0, right? So we will get it as 18. Then I have minus 4 into 1 is minus 4, minus 6 7 is 42. Then I have 7 into 0 is 0, right? Minus 1 into 3 is minus 3. So I will get the values as 18, minus 46 and minus 3. This is how we have to find the cross product, right? So let's take an example of any two values here. So let me consider the cross product of E4 and E5. E4 was represented as 0 to 0 and E5 was represented as minus 3, 0, 0. I am referring to the polygon whichever I drew now, right? So now finding the cross product of E4 cross E5. Simple, it is 0 to 0. 0 to 0, then write E5 minus 3 0 0 minus 3 0 C. Right, leave the first column, multiply these two, take the values as x, y, and z. Multiply these two, you'll get 2 into 0 is 0 minus 0 into 0 is C. Then 0 into minus 3 is 0 minus 0 into 0 is 0. Right, so then I have 0 into 0 is 0. Minus 3 into 2 is minus 6, so minus into minus is plus 6. I will get 0, 0, 6, right? So like this, we will get the cross product, right? So once we get the cross product, right? So we have to find the cross product between successive pair. So E1 cross E2 we have to find. Then we have to find E2 cross E3, E3 cross E4, E4 cross E5, E5 cross E6 and E6 cross E1, right? So like this, we have to find the cross products of successive pairs. E1 to E2, E2 to E3, E3 to E4, E4 to E5, E5 to E6 and E6 to E1, right? So if I find the cross products of all the vectors, right? So then I will get a negative component along the vector E2 cross E3. Right, so here I will get the negative value of the vector, right? Something I will get like 0, 0, minus 2, something I will get, right? So whenever I get the negative value, right, so we have to split the polygon at that particular end. So what we do is, we have our polygon like this. This was my polygon. Was my polygon, right? So this is my E1, this is my E2, in here this is E3, again in here E4, then I had E5, then we had E6, right? So we got the cross product of E2 and E3. E2 cross E3 is less than 0, right? So since it is negative, I have to split my polygon here, right? So I will split. This is my splitting. I will split my concave polygon here, right? So once I split the polygon, what I will get is, I will get this part as one polygon, right? And this particular part as one polygon. This part as one polygon and this particular part as one polygon. Right? So I have splitted my concave polygon into two parts, right? So this is one convex polygon, this is one convex polygon. Now I can make use of my any polygon filling algorithm in order to fill this polygon. Clear? So the second method is called as rotation method. Second method of splitting the concave polygon. The second method of splitting the concave polygon is rotation method. So in this rotation method, what we do is we just rotate the polygon, right? So this was our polygon. This was my polygon. So what do we do is here in this, the first step is we have to rotate the polygon, right? So in such a way we have to rotate the polygon in anti-clockwise direction. Rotate the polygon in anti-clockwise direction so that the polygon will fix to coordinate origin. Right? So means what? If I take this particular polygon, right? So edge is starting from here, right? So I will get this as vertex 1. This is my vertex 2, vertex 3. This is my vertex 1, from here 0th line it is starting, vertex 1, this is my vertex 2, this is vertex 3, vertex 4, vertex 5 and vertex 6, right? So now for this particular polygon, what I will do is I will rotate it is in anti-clockwise direction like this. I will rotate it in anti-clockwise direction so that it will move and it will come, right? So if I rotate it in anti-clockwise direction, what happens? This vertex, if I take this as my origin, right? So it will be rotated and this edge will come here because I have to fix that particular vertex to coordinate origin. So vertex 1 will be here, right? So vertex 2 will come. From here, I am just shifting it. Right, so vertex 1 to vertex 2. Then I will vertex 3, the edge E3 will come here. Just rotate the edges. I am rotating the edges in anti-clockwise direction, right, so that they will come here. Right, so if I take this, this edge will come here. So my vertex V1 and V2 will be here. Again, V2 to V3, right. So again, the vertex 4 will come down. Then I will get V5 somewhere here. V6 here again coming back, right? So just shifting that polygon in anti-clockwise direction. Just rotate this polygon in anti-clockwise direction and see that your vertices are fixed like this, right? So when you are rotating and you are making them to coincide with the or correspond with the coordinate origin, if at all you get any vertex, if at all I get any vertex below the x-axis, right? So then I say that particular polygon is a concave polygon, right? So then splitting will happen along the x-axis. I will split my polygon here. Splitting happens along the x-axis, right? So I repeat, in my rotation method, what I am doing, I will take my original polygon and I will rotate it anti-clockwise direction, right? So when I rotate this polygon in anti-clockwise direction, right? So this edge will come here. V1, V2, this edge will coincide like this. Right? So when V3 comes here, what happens to V4? It will come down, right? Again, V5 will come somewhere here and V6. That is what is happening here. V1 to V2, V2 to V3, to V4, V5 and V6. Right? So when I get this rotated polygon, right? So I will check whether I have any vertex below the x-axis. If I have any vertex below the x-axis, then that particular polygon, I characterize it as a concave polygon, right? And I will split it along the x-axis. So I will be splitting this polygon along the x-axis. So I will get this as part as my one polygon, this particular part as one polygon, and this particular part as one polygon, right? So I have splitted a concave polygon into two convex polygons. Thank you.